Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Literary Theory for Robots, How Computers Learned to Write, by Dennis Yi Tenen. Narrated by Rebecca Lam. Publisher's note. In this audio edition, you will hear references to a table present in the print and ebook formats of the book. Chapter 1. Intelligence as Metaphor. An Introduction. Computers love to read. And it isn't just fiction before going to bed. They read greedily. All literature, all of the time. Novels, encyclopedias, academic articles, private messages, advertisements, love letters, news stories, hate speech, and crime reports. Everything written and transmitted, no matter how insignificant. This ingested printed matter contains the messiness of human wisdom and emotion, the information and disinformation, fact and metaphor. While we were building railroads, fighting wars, and buying shoes online, the machine child went to school. Literary computers scribble everywhere now in the background, powering search engines, recommendations systems, and customer service chatbots. They flag offensive content on social networks and delete spam from our inboxes. At the hospital, they help convert patient-doctor conversations into insurance billing codes. Sometimes, they alert law enforcement to potential terrorist plots and predict poorly the threat of violence on social media. Legal professionals use them to hide or discover evidence of corporate fraud. Students are writing their next school paper with the aid of a smart word processor, capable not just of completing sentences, but generating entire essays on any topic. In the industrial age, automation came for the shoemaker and the factory line worker. Today, it has come for the writer, the professor, the physician, and the attorney. All human activity now passes through a computational pipeline. Even the sanitation worker transforms effluence into data. Like it or not, we have all become subjects to automation. To survive intact, we must also learn to become part software engineers and part, well, whatever you are doing is great. If any of the previous statements comes as a surprise to you, my job, I feel, is mostly done. Curiosity piqued, you will now start noticing literary robots everywhere and join me in pondering their origins. Those not surprised, perhaps, believe erroneously that these siliconites have learned to chat only recently, somewhere on the fields of computer science or software engineering. I am here to tell you that machines have been getting smarter in this way for centuries, long before computers, advancing on far more arcane grounds, like rhetoric, linguistics, hermeneutics, literary theory, semiotics, and philology. So that we may hear them speak, to read and understand a vast library of machine texts, I want to introduce several essential ideas underpinning the ordinary magic of literary computers. Hidden deep within the circuitry of everyday devices, yes, even smart light bulbs and refrigerators, we will find tiny poems that have yet to name their genre. By the end of the book, I hope you can see this technology anew, replete not just with instrumental capacity to keep food cold or to give light, but with potential for creativity and collaboration. Throughout, we will be tempted to ask existential questions about the nature of artificially intelligent things. How smart are they? Do they really think or understand our language? Will they ever, have they ever, become sentient? Such questions are impossible to answer, in the way asked, because the very categories of consciousness derive from human experience. To understand alien life forms, we must think in alien ways. And rather than argue about definitions, are they smart or not, we can begin to describe the ways in which the meaning of intelligence continues to evolve. Not long ago, one way of appearing smart involved memorizing a bunch of obscure facts to become like a walking encyclopedia. Today, that way of knowing seems like a waste of precious mental space, Vast online databases make effective search habits more important than rote memorization. Intelligence changes. The puzzle of its essence cannot therefore be assembled from sharp binary attitudes, laid out always and everywhere in the same way. Can machines think, yes or no? Rather, we can start putting the pieces together contextually, at specific times and places, and from the view of an evolving shared capacity. How do they think? And how do we think with them? And how does that change the meaning of thinking? In answering the how questions, we will discover a strange sort of twinned history, spanning the arts and sciences. Humans have been thinking in this way, with and through machines, for centuries, just as they have been thinking with and through us. The mind, hand, and tool move at once, in unison. But the way we train minds, hands, or tools treats them almost like entirely separate appendages, located in different buildings, in unrelated fields on a university campus. Such an educational model isolates ends from means and means from ends, disempowering its publics. In this volume, I would like to imagine an alternative, more integrated curriculum offered to poets and engineers alike, bound, eventually, for a machine reader as part of another training corpus. Next time you pick up a smart device, like a book or a phone, pause mid-use to reflect on your body posture. You are watching a video or writing an email, perhaps. The mind moves, requiring mental prowess like perception and interpretation. But the hand moves, too, animating body in concert with technology. Pay attention to the posture of the intellect, the way your head tilts, the movement of individual fingers, pressing buttons or pointing in particular ways. Feel the glass of the screen, the roughness of paper, leaf and swipe. Such physical rituals, incantations manifesting thought, body, and tool, bring forth the artifice of intellect. The whole thing is it. And that's already kind of the point. Thinking happens in the mind, by the hand, with a tool, and, by extension, with the help of others. Thought moves by mental powers, alongside the physical, the instrumental, and the social. What separates natural from artificial forces in that chain? Does natural intelligence end where I think something to myself, silently, alone? How about using a notebook or calling a friend for advice? What about going to the library or consulting an encyclopedia or in conversation with a machine? None of the boundaries seem convincing. Intelligence demands artifice. Webster's dictionary defines intelligence as the skilled use of reason. Artifice itself stems from the Latin ars, signifying skilled work, and facere, meaning to make. In other words, artificial intelligence just means reason plus skill. There are no hard boundaries here, only synergy between the human mind and its extensions. What about smart objects? First thing in the morning, I stretch and, at the same time, reach for my phone to check my schedule, read the news, and bask in the faint glow of kudos, hearts, and likes from various social apps. How did I get into this position? I ask alongside the beetle from Kafka's The Metamorphosis. Who taught me to move like this? It wasn't planned, really. Nor are we actually beetles living in our natural habitat, an ancient forest floor. Our intimate rituals morph organically in response to a changing environment. We dwell inside crafted spaces, containing the designs for a purposeful living. The room says, eat here, sleep there. The bed, lie on me this way. The screen, hold me like this. Smart objects further change in response to our inputs. To do that, they must be able to communicate, to contain a layer of written instructions. Somewhere in the linkage between the tap of my finger and the responding pixel on screen, an algorithm has registered my preference for a morning routine. I am the input and output. the tools evolve as they transform me in return. And so I go back to bed. The chapters of this book correspond to what I see as the three major gaps in our collective thinking about artificial intelligence. First, I will argue that our understanding of AI can and must become more grounded in the history of the humanities. Second, that a software engineering education necessarily involves a number of inescapable philosophical problems related to several nerdy, but I'm sure you'll find them fascinating, kinds of textual matters. Finally, I propose to consider AI as part of the broader social and political dynamics arising, more generally, from the automation of labor, particularly as it concerns intellectual labor or knowledge work. History will remain my first and primary concern. Insert something clever here about forgetting the past to the detriment of the future. Any field developing rapidly, as computer science has been, can be forgiven for orienting itself toward the future, but not for long. Yes, one can learn to type quickly or to write a spreadsheet macro without a second thought. Reflect, however, on the immense frustration of commandeering all of our clumsy, impoverished digital avatars. You want me to save a what where? File? Folder? Server? Cloud? The pervasive presence of metaphors should hint at the extent of our collective alienation. What is a file? Wherefore a folder? Why are they even called that? Who thought of putting exactly 8 bits into a byte? And why not 9? How does a keystroke transform itself into a configuration of pixels on screen, forming a letter? Explain a common algorithm used to search, finish sentences when typing, filter spam, or to recommend products. No way, too much. Such questions fall out of serious consideration because, paradoxically, they are too simple for computer science and way, way too complex for baseline literacy. But first, why do history? One can simply launch into the future from the state of the art, the state of the present. At least 2 points are needed to make a line, however. History's subtle advantage lies in the revealing of trajectories through time. AI, and indeed artifice or intellect, and even the toasting of bread, represent a cluster of related objects, ideas, techniques, practices, and institutions. A static snapshot contains their anatomy in 3 dimensions. This is how toasters work, and this is how a mind thinks today. History expands these arrangements into the 4th dimension of time. Like any technology, the mind changes over time. Its anatomical hardware stays the same, but the software receives regular updates. All those encyclopedias, calculators, search tools, and other smart devices that amplify the powers to reason. Yet this history of AI should have nothing to do with the recent resurgence of covertly neo-Hegelian thought so popular with futurists and disruptive entrepreneurs, who believe in some sort of teleological event horizon, past which humankind will attain a post-human singularity. All challenges met, competitors bested, obstacles overcome. A singularity that leads to the end of history sounds both contemptible and horrific. I'm not sure if humans would survive it. History cannot be personified in that way. It isn't leading us to salvation or transcendence. It has no post-human goals as such, other than those we make for ourselves. On a less apocalyptic scale, history allows for extrapolation. It helps anticipate changes in the direction of travel. Without history, our ideals and our policies lack sufficient foresight to prepare adequately and to alter course if needed. Without history, society is doomed to struggle with long-term effects of technology, such as pollution and urban sprawl, and soon, if not already, AI. History ultimately makes for better engineers and users of technology. Any complicated gadget contains within it a number of contingencies that appear senseless today because they were attained through a compromise with past limitations. QWERTY, the layout of modern English keyboards, for example, was famously arranged in that order to slow down typing on typewriters that jammed otherwise. Similarly, 8 bits, or ones and zeros, make a byte, or a unit of information, by convention. The number 8 holds little significance. The arbitrary length always confused me, until I learned that early telegraph systems also experimented with variable bit encoding, such as the Morse code, which can have anywhere between 1 and 5 bits, as well as fixed encoding, like the 5-bit Baudot code, deriving from earlier cryptographic ciphers proposed by Francis Bacon and others in the early 17th century. The linear ticker tape, used in telegraphs subsequently, could break a string of punches into any arbitrary length. It just so happens that the rectangular punch card in use by early tabulating census machines, and later by IBM, would not physically fit more than 8 characters across, in rows of 70 to 80 columns stacked. The convention of an 8-bit byte and the 80-character code line persisted, even though magnetic tape and later hard drive media were no longer constrained by those limitations. The physical properties of cardboard thus continue to inform the design of modern computers. The abstract and alien concept of bits became concrete to me by imagining holes punched through cardboard. On a recent trip to Kyrgyzstan, a friendly librarian gifted me a punch card used by Soviet computers in 1977. I use it as a bookmark now, but its neat rows and columns still help conjure the rather elusive byte as an object. History gives meaning to such inherited structures. In following the evolution of technology, we are able to make sense of legacy technological debt. Whatever is meant by innovation consists of realizing which features of the inherited design remain necessary, and which can be discarded or improved. Without history, the present becomes invariable, sliding into orthodoxy, or it is what it is. History's milestones mark a path into a possible future. It's okay, then, to sometimes struggle with basic file operations alongside some of my best data science students. Believe in yourself, Dennis! How can I consider myself literate if I don't fully understand how writing works? A technical answer isn't enough either. How writing works cannot be reduced to the present technological moment, because that moment will pass, and rapidly. Instead, writing has come to mean this specific arrangement of mind, body, tool, circuit, bit, gate, through its historical development. An obtuse technological concept, such as solid-state memory storage or the quantum shimmer behind words on screen, obtains meaning only through a specific genealogy, from ticker tape to punch card and to the not-and gates flickering silently in the palm of your hand. At the very least, the erasure of such realities stunts intellectual growth. Good engineers need history, because the progress of their education can follow the gradual development of their subject matter. History leads to deep understanding, because it explains why and how something has come to be the way it is. Without it, we passively inherit a bundle of meaningless facts. It's just the way things are. Poets steeped in engineering, likewise, stand to understand something vital about the nature of writing. Or sign, symbol, inscription, representation, if you want to get fancy. From that perspective, writing machines can be seen as the culmination of a long mythical tradition. In the beginning, there was the letter. Then, a byte came to encode 8 bits, because 8 was enough to represent a character. Characters formed words and commands in a string. The string ate its own tail and learned to rewrite itself. There were the early days of autopoiesis, the writing that writes itself. What we teach today as the history of literature is also but an episode of a larger emerging storyline. Its continuing evolution must involve the people of the word. Each turn of the historical screw brings wonder, quickly fading into the ordinary. Who remembers the 9th century Persian mathematician, Muhammad ibn Musa al-Khwarizmi, still with us in his algorithms? Or what of Ramon Llull, the Majorcan monk who studied rhetorical combination in the 13th century? Did he invent one of the earliest chatbots with his rotating paper charts? Or did their origins lie in ancient divination charts, like the Zairaja described by the great medieval historian Ibn Khaldun, or the I Ching, or Book of Changes, written in the Western Zhou period? Can I tell you also that Llull inspired Francis Bacon and Gottfried Leibniz to propose their binary cipher systems, influenced also by the Chinese tradition? What about the Wunderkammern of the German Baroque poets in the 17th century? These curious drawer cabinets, literally furniture, could be pulled in any arrangement to produce beautiful music and poetry, to the delight and horror of the audience. A long tradition of language machines also includes An Essay Towards a Real Character and a Philosophical Language by John Wilkins. Written in 1668, the book imagines a new system of writing that would function as a kind of translation protocol between cultures, commercial interests, and religions. Later, the mathematical notion of a Markov chain, central to contemporary AI, developed out of a paper on Pushkin's poetry. These mostly forgotten artifacts remain in the background of contemporary computation. Later, we'll have the chance to pluck a few of them out, unplug and hold them for a bit, to see how the whole thing fits together. In writing this book, I was surprised to discover the history of computing permeated by distinctly literary puzzles. But to see a past shared between literature and technology has implied, also, the recognition of their altered present. Technology continues to reconfigure human orientation to the word. To study the history of literature today is to go beyond the familiar categories, like fact or fiction, or even science and the humanities, art and technology. Instead, our thread leads to an entirely separate branch of the symbolic arts, practiced on a massive scale, on the work floors of intellectual labor across diverse industries. Here, we can find stories produced by the MITRE Corporation, one of the largest military contractors in the world, woven deep inside the Cold War-era missile defense systems, encounter fairy tales written by airplanes as part of Boeing's effort to automate their incident reporting systems, or visit the vector space supporting everyday search engine recommendations. To what genre do these texts belong? On which bookshelf should we file them? How do we read something so fundamentally unfit for human consumption? The advance of artificial intellect obviously implicates a number of open-ended metaphysical questions. From these, I want to highlight a subset related to the subject of my expertise: literature, poetics, semiotics, philology, textual studies, the study of inscription and incantation. For example, et al., etc., the arcane arts. Except, not really that arcane, because though people these days read fewer things labeled literature, they consume more literature than ever. Text weaves through the online digital world, stitching it together. It bonds and bounds whatever is meant by artificial intelligence, in the way an encyclopedia or a library holds the sum total of human knowledge. The search engine or chatbot is just an outer garment, draped over the complication within. A body of written works sustains all organized human activity. I don't mean to suggest that all things are textual. The world becomes truly visible to a literary scholar only through the looking glass of inscription. For example, unlike your well-adjusted physician, I know little about and am uncomfortable around bodies. A patient exists for physicians as a living body first, but that's not all a patient becomes in a hospital. Patient histories, or stories, may be recorded to supplement a physician's notes. A recording of their consultation will be transcribed and transcoded into a digital file. It will be translated from one system to another in multiple formats. It will be redacted, edited, compressed, processed, and mined for missing billable codes. This record will be sold and resold and used to train automated diagnostic bots of the future. It will be summarized, cataloged, tagged, and archived for later use. A body, in the sense of the literal Latin corpus, has thus been transformed into the English corpus, figuratively, a collection of textual records. Much of this churn implicates automated, artificial, and otherwise intelligent work. But neither the physician nor the hospital administrator may consider it as such. Though a patient's journey from body to record leads directly to health outcomes and to a hospital's finances, it remains without a guide, meandering through multiple inherited legacy systems. Here, a sharp-eyed arcanist may find a worthwhile mystery. Finally, a puzzle for those who have studied exactly these sorts of things, like corpuses and taxonomies, editions and redactions, catalogs, summaries, translations and archives, a rich trove of textual goodies. In this book, we will similarly observe the history of artificial intelligence through the looking glass of inscription. History tells us that computers compute not only in the mathematical sense, but universally. The number was incidental to the symbol. In the 1840s, Ada Lovelace, daughter of Lord Byron and one of the first programmers in the modern sense, imagined an engine that could manipulate any symbolic information whatsoever, not just numbers. A century later, Alan Turing extended that blueprint to imagine a universal machine, capable of reading from and writing to an infinite string of characters. The children of Turing and Lovelace occupying our homes are therefore expert generic symbol manipulators. They are smart because they are capable of interpreting abstract variables, containing values, representing anything and everything. Modern machines read and write. And because they carry language, we readily imagine them capable of higher-order functions like sympathy or sentience. But how do machines grow from handling inert textual matter to living language? Why do they seem to exceed their programming by telling jokes, making complex logical inferences, or writing poetry? Metaphor holds the key to their slow awakening. Algebraic values can signify human values. X equals Y arranges two variable entities into a familiar relation. X can also be assigned to ideas like cat or dog, or an action like call home or order milk. The art of manipulating symbols leads to a game of metaphors in which certain inscriptions or gestures stand for something else. Children, spies, and poets love to play games like these. When I call, after Shakespeare, the night thick, I mean it to be particularly dark, humid, and full of anticipation. The metaphor packs a lot of meaningful baggage into a compact transport. Similarly, a machine becomes smart by rising higher and higher through the circles of spiraling prose. Thanks, Winfried Jörg Siebald. Symbol emerges from inert hardware, gesturing toward things that we care about, like flagging offensive content, deleting spam, fighting terrorism, or indeed shopping for shoes. Care is also a value, but can machines really soar or crawl from simple values like X and Y to complex ones like care, equity, freedom, or justice? Are you human? Is there anything inside? Can machines think? Or are you just trolling me? We'll give such textual philosophical distractions a good go throughout the book. In conclusion, we will move to a few practical, that is to say, political and economic and even personally psychological, considerations. Insert a wise, pithy aphorism about the social good, career choice, the means of production, the future of creativity. This is the so what part. How will my life change, and what is to be done? The mistake, if I may spoil the punchline, was ever to imagine intelligence in a vat of...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.